Hello, I'm Captain Matthew Webb, and back in 1875, I was the very first person to swim the channel. Now, more than 300 people do it every year, they tell me. Most of them train in that little pond in London called the Serpentine. And that's where the quacks got the idea for this here BMJ paper.
The thing about this stretch of water is that this is a training ground for channel swimming. This is actually the place where probably most people will do their training.
Well done.
Next year's the 140th anniversary of the first channel crossing by Captain Webb. Extraordinary feat then, and still not easy, even with a lot of modern understanding of physiology and how to train and how to feed during the crossing. We know lots of people who would really love to swim the channel. They're training for it, relays, solos. And we heard some great stories about what they were doing and also the difficulties they'd had.
Some people struggle to get across because they haven't trained for the distance, but some people have more medical type problems, and we got very interested in hearing more about those, understanding them a little bit better.
Since my successful swim, thousands of hearty lads and lasses have had a go. One such is a nice young lady named Vicky Miller. So, we will relate the story of my swim and Vicky's, and here and there give you a tally of the particular perils to health, the dire straits of Dover, if you will. Firstly, the pulmonary peril.
The important medical condition is swimming-induced pulmonary edema that not that many people suffer from. If they do, it's significant. It is to do with swimming. It's well known in scuba divers too.
Nasty. I started my swim just before 1 in the afternoon. Vicky Miller, 1 in the morning. I was smothered in porpoise grease to stave off the cold. They don't seem to bother with that much nowadays. After commencing my swim, I immediately felt the pull of the tide taking me off course. I would pay heavily for starting so late.
5 minutes to feed.
The feeding peril. At 4 p.m, I partook of some good strong beef tea. Later, I had cod liver oil and a few nips of brandy.
Can you tell us a little bit more about what you ate during the swim? Because 11 hours is obviously a long time to go without food, so you must have stopped to eat along the way.
Yeah, absolutely. So it's critical to keep the energy levels up by trying to take in as much energy as you can, although your body can obviously only absorb so much, so it's quite tricky to get that right balance. So I mixed my feeds between a carbohydrate drink, Maxi, and then also I had talk gels, Milky Ways, Jelly Babies, and tinned peaches. So part of it was for the energy, and the other part of variety was almost to give myself a mental boost when I was looking forward to having a certain treat. So I did feeds every half an hour for the liquid, and then I had a solid feed every hour. So it was lowered to me in a cup, and I fed water while I had it, and then it was lowered down, and I would have it as quickly as possible.
Well done.
You got it.
Woo!
I tried out a lot of foods and training, but for example, I like to have chocolate, but I couldn't have chocolate in the channel because it was cluttering my mouth. It was like wax in my mouth, so I stopped chocolate. What was the nicest was tinned peaches. It gave a kind of freshness. You felt it would be fresh food coming in, and you could swallow it because it's very, very soft.
So the contrast with the salt.
And the contrast with the salt, so you feel there's something real coming into your body. Lots of people get problems from the salt and the sugar mix because it's a very unnatural diet, because you need to have sugar ready all the time, and you get problems like vomiting. You have to vomit into the water, obviously, or you need to have diarrhea and you defecate in the water.
The peril of salt mouth.
Tell us about the salt mouth.
Because I spent 14 and a half hours in the water, and the channel is very salty, I struggled to speak for a day. I couldn't speak at all. I couldn't close my mouth because everything was so swollen. I need about 3 days to regain eating any normal food that I would usually eat. I couldn't eat for 3 days.
How was it?
It's much better inside than in the wind.
Better in the water.
But it's fairly warm.
Vicky was much quicker than I was. It took me 10 hours to get halfway across. Half that time for her. Now, this is where the challenges really begin, including the imaginary peril. Many of my successors seem to lose their wits.
One of the things that I thought was most interesting was the psychological problems that people suffer from when they're swimming in a situation with very few visual cues, hour after hour, situations of sensory deprivation, really, when you're swimming the channel. And people can start to suffer strange illusions and even hallucinations in that condition.
And so I got hallucinations on my first swim, never had it in training. I remember swimming along, and it all feels quite logical, but I looked up at my support boat, you know, which is relatively small, and it just looked like a huge battleship. I remember looking up, and it looked like it was 60, 70 metres high, you know, to where I could see the people standing. And you do see the odd container ship moving around, and I just thought, oh, this is the wrong boat. Where am I? And I looked around, I remember swimming around, looking around at sea everywhere, and I couldn't see any other boats anywhere apart from this battleship. And I remember my mind just logically saying, well, that must be my boat then, and then just carrying on swimming.
The hypothermic peril.
So obviously one of the problems about swimming the channel is the temperature. So depending on the time of year, in September, you know, you may find it dropping 8 or 9 degrees C or lower.
For reasons that perhaps aren't very clear, you can start to feel you're performing incredibly well and you don't feel the cold.
On a particular day, which had freak climatic conditions, it was in February, the air temperature was 72. This was like an alpine day. There wasn't a cloud in the sky. The water was flat calm. It was like a mirror. It was absolutely wonderful. What I didn't know was, in fact, that earlier in the morning there had been ice on the water. And because it was such a wonderful day, I thought, OK, I'm actually going to swim quite a distance. And I got in at about 10 to 9, and I swam until 9:30. I felt absolutely terrific. And when I got out, I was in a coma. The paramedics arrived here. They took my body temperature and it was 84. It was 14 degrees lower than the norm. I actually felt I was actually dying.
Well, it's awfully difficult to avoid, because once you start getting it, it's just so enjoyable. You feel fantastic. It's actually the best feeling I've had in my life, when I was beginning to get hypothermia.
The thing about hypothermia is that it's almost as if your head and your body have a different agenda. The head is saying, this is absolutely fantastic. The body actually is shutting down. And hypothermia can overcome you literally in a couple of minutes.
We loved your description about it's like being drunk. And once you start getting to that stage where you're slightly drunk, you don't refuse the next glass, you keep on going.
You keep going. It really is just like that. The better you feel, the less you're likely to stop. Because it's just wonderful. That was my experience. And the more I swam, the warmer I began to feel. I thought it was because I was swimming so well that my arms were just whizzing round and I was feeling hotter and hotter.
That feeling of well-being actually produces heat in the body. And so as you're swimming along, your body feels as if it's getting warmer and warmer. That is the danger point. If you're swimming in cold water and you feel it's cold, you're safe. If it begins to become a very pleasant experience where the body is warm, that's when the danger point is.
Actually, quite warm.
Goodness.
Is it? You're steaming. The serpentine. Not cold at all.
Nobody these days thinks that what I ate on my swim was right. So now, the eating peril.
So a lot of us, for insurance, we put on extra weight to try and insulate ourselves from the cold. Typically, as soon as we come out of a 6-7 hour swim, I'll eat a large piece of fruitcake, maybe 3 rounds of sandwiches, some donuts. Then I'll go and get changed, and then I'll go for a meal. Typically, I would be eating a starter, three main courses, and a dessert. And then in the night, I'd get up and wake and eat something else to try and put on weight.
Bleh. I recommend a strict diet of bones.
I made sure that I didn't lose any weight. I knew that it was really important for me to keep the same weight as I am, which is 11 stone, and I didn't want to lose any of that through the hard training. So I was eating huge amounts and had to remind myself to have two breakfasts and have like second portions. And it was quite harder than I expected to make sure I kept eating enough.
I put on so much weight that I got hiatus hernia. So after the swim, I had to lose weight quite quickly. Probably within 3 or 4 months, I was back to normal.
The stinging peril. After being in the water some 8 hours, I was stung by a horrible jellyfish.
I'm stung!
It was, however, but a flesh wound, and after a nip of brandy, I pressed on.
Well, probably the thing I was most scared about in advance was the jellyfish. So it was really something that had bothered me quite a lot in the year in advance, and so much so that I'd had nightmares about jellyfish.
The worst part most swimmers go on about is the separation zone, because that's where you get all the weed and the debris and everything else. If you're gonna find jellyfish, that's where you find the biggest cluster of them.
Go on, girl. Go on, girl.
Well, you try to avoid the big patches of weed and everything else, but jellyfish, you don't see it until it's too late. They're coming down the side of the boat before you see them. But no, big patches of weed, I try and avoid those, because they do freak the swimmer out, wouldn't they?
There was a few minor jellyfish stings, but nothing that really bothered me too much, so it was quite easy to keep going through the swim.
The tidal peril. 3 a.m. I asked for some more beef tea, which was promptly administered. I was anxious, as the tide was about to turn once more and take me away from my destination, Cape Grisnez.
There's a small peninsula that sticks out, which when you're swimming across, that's the shortest piece. But the water's moving like a river, backwards and forwards, the current. And if you miss that headland, then you can end up swimming for an extra 2 hours to get to land. So you think you're almost there, and suddenly you've got an extra 2 hours to swim.
Most vexing. Vicky Miller's trajectory was a beautiful curve, heading towards Cape Grisnez. She had calculated her swim perfectly. I, on the other hand, had gone seriously awry. I had drifted 7 miles to the east at this point. At 10 a.m. I was fearfully exhausted. However, Calais Pier was in sight. At 10:37, a little under 22 hours since I began, my face encrusted in salt, I touched ground. I had done it.
Just over 11 hours crossing the English Channel. How do you feel?
I'm so happy and so relieved it's done.
Every year there are more people doing extreme sports, endurance sports, proving that they can do something. And at the end of it, the buzz, of course, is phenomenal.
It's done.
Right, woo! Well done, Vicky.
And so to the Paris Hotel Calais, where I was plied with hot port wine.
Getting that pebble from the beach. That's the thing you want to do. You want to get the pebble off the French beach, and that's your pebble that you take home as your souvenir. That's what it's about, getting the pebble.